Dr. Kary Mullis, Nobel Prize-winning chemist, is a 1962 graduate of Dreer High School in Richland, District 1. Interested in science from a young age, he received a Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry from the Georgia Institute of Technology in 1966. And in 1972, he earned a PhD in biochemistry from the University of California, Berkeley. He has done postdoctoral work in both pediatric cardiology and pharmaceutical chemistry. Beginning in 1979, Dr. Mullis spent 7 years at the Cetus Corporation in Emeryville, California as a DNA chemist, where he invented the polymerase chain reaction, PCR, hailed as one of the monumental scientific techniques of the 20th century. A method of amplifying DNA, PCR multiplies a single microscopic strand of the genetic material billions of times within hours. The process has multiple applications in medicine, genetics, biotechnology, and forensics. In 1993, Dr. Mullis received a Nobel Prize in chemistry, as well as the Japan Prize, one of international science's most prestigious awards for his invention of the PCR. His many other awards include the Thomas A. Edison Award, California Scientist of the Year Award, the National Biotechnology Award, the R&D Scientist of the Year, and the William Allen Memorial Award of the American Society of Human Genetics. Dr. Mullis was presented the honorary degree of Doctor of Science from the University of South Carolina in 1994 and inducted into the Inventors Hall of Fame in 1998. He has authored several major patents, including the PCR technology and UV-sensitive plastic that changes color in response to light. Dr. Mullis serves on the board of scientific advisors of several companies, provides expert advice in legal matters involving DNA, and lectures at college campuses, corporations, and academic meetings around the world.
Yeah, my English degree doesn't look so hot right now. Dr. Mullis could not be here this evening. However, his good friend, Mr. Al Montgomery, will accept the award on his behalf. Please welcome Mr. Montgomery.
Kary wanted me to make sure that I extended his appreciation for this, everybody here in the foundation. He has won worldwide awards over the years, lectured all over the world. He's really appreciative of being able to get this kind of record. Really, really meant a lot. He was sorry he couldn't be here, and you're going to have to put up with me for a little while. I want to thank Lisa for reminding me to bring my folder with me. Otherwise, I'd have been here, standing here, probably not doing anything, just looking at you kind of dumbly the whole time. Anyway, I not only feel real fortunate, but very proud and happy to have known Kary as well. We met 1958 at Hand Junior High School. And I didn't really get to know him then. Next year at Dreer, we became fast friends. And I don't really recall exactly how we got together and became such good friends. But after 60 years, I thought whatever it was, pretty good. He and I, at Dreer, everyone else, a lot of freedom to move about, do things at school than they do, and that be just place. But we, at one time, we were in the jet school. He and I, several other people got together in some way. I don't know whether we were invited or we fought our way in or whatever, but we were to put on a science show for A.C. Moore Elementary School. And so the chemistry teacher didn't know that much about chemistry. Jets Club, he was kind of busy. And so we were sort of given free rein to come up with a program, and they opened up the stock room for us, and we went in there and we devised several things that we thought would entertain the elementary school students, and we knew quite well would entertain ourselves. We had this one thing, we were going to get, Kary was going to be the MC, and we were all going to put on a little sort of five or demonstration of some kind of scientific concept. And we decided we'd start it off really dramatically. So we were going to have this sort of volcano thing in the middle of the stage. We were going to have Stravinsky's Firebird Suite playing in the background. The curtains would open partially, the volcano would start up, and the Stravinsky would be blaring out, and the curtains would open, and Kary would walk out and start introducing everything. Well, we were doing our dress rehearsal the night before, and the little recipe we had was called potassium chlorate and some other thing. And we couldn't find any potassium chlorate, but we did find some potassium perchlorate. And if you were a chemist, you'd realize how funny that is. But potassium perchlorate is a number of times more reactive than potassium chlorate. So we had our little volcano going. We put it in this little metal crucible, and it was queuing up. All of a sudden, good God, what happened? So we got our collective heads together and decided that the metal crucible catalyzed something, fed up this. But we didn't have a chance to do it again, but we said we'll use a ceramic crucible and everything will be. Well, the next day we had the first through third graders in there, and the same doggone thing happened again. So anyway, we for the second performance we decided that we wouldn't do that. We'd do something that we knew was a little more sedate. And so it went a lot better then. We thought we entertained the students, and we think we were honored so much. We did such a good job, they've never allowed anybody else to do that again. Anyway, Kary and I, we went off. He inspired me to become a chemist. I always wanted to be some kind of scientist. I wasn't sure what. He led me on the route to chemist. He didn't either. He went to Georgia Tech, and I went to Clemson, and we got back, and after our sophomore year of school, we independently got jobs at the same place, South Beltline, working for the factory company. If they had known we were such good friends and everything, they'd done that. Did. So we had a great time. We were probably other than the owner of the company, we were only chemists there. They had a lot of technicians. Had some engineers. We were sort of turned loose in the lab, and we just had all this wonderful equipment to work with. Learned a great deal and had a really good time. We decided we were going to start our own chemical company. Kary had worked a company the summer before, sort of working in their catalog area and translating some stuff, doing synonyms for chemicals. But as you buy one thing, it could have a dozen different things. That helped out a lot. But the guy that ran the company, Max Gergel, said, well, if you ever want to make chemicals, we said, well, we'll get back. He can give us some stuff. So we bought $40 worth of glass, borrowed some equipment from Cardinal. They were real good about it. And Max gave us some things to make. We didn't know at the time, but they were these dogs that nobody else was. We started out in my mother's garage, and we made this stuff called nitrosobenzene. Great stuff. It smelled weird, and it was a white crystalline solid when you got it purified. When you were distilling it, it was emerald green. I mean, it couldn't be more exciting than that. It goes through all these transitions. So we made that successful. Max was all excited. He wanted us to make phenacyl bromide. The next phenacyl bromide chemically is very similar to tear gas. But we weren't idiots. We had both had sophomore organic, and so we pretty well knew everything there was to know about chemistry. That we thought. So we made the phenacyl bromide, and we're crying and weeping and sneezing and everything. And Kary said, "What's going on here?" I said, "This isn't gas. It's not a gas." I said, "It's still getting us." Bad, that's what I was saying. It's a solid, but we didn't figure on that. We would have to run in and out of things, gas. Got it finished about 3 o'clock in the morning, and we pulled out of the driveway, and Kary said he noticed the camellia bush side of the garage where we had this box window box fan that ventilation, and the camellia bush looked like it was suffering mightily. Leaves were dropping off, and so. But Kary said, "Well, your mother probably has other camellia bushes." So I said, "Okay, so we locked the garage and we put a note on it: don't go in here, whatever." But anyway, my grandmother didn't feel any need to read any signs. She just went on in the garage where the washer dryer was, and she was going to do some laundry. And so she breaks out into tears. She doesn't understand what's going on, you know. She's an emotional wreck. She's crying. She doesn't know why. So she comes back out of there. Anyway, that was one of the incidents that made us realize that we needed to move out of the neighborhood. Another one was some strange, noxious cloud that they figured we were the genesis of around the neighborhood. So we were not run out, but we were encouraged leave. So the next year we moved the operation, next summer, we moved the operation to sister's property where she had an old chicken house, and we converted the chicken house into this wonderful experimental entity, and we worked there all summer. And we didn't make a whole lot of money, but we had a great deal of experience. Max said, "Well, just think of all the valuable experience." So we said, "Well, be a little more valuable if we got paid." So, but we did that for a couple of years, actually. Then Kary went off to Berkeley to graduate. I went to the University of South Carolina. I was accepted to Georgia and South Carolina, and I said, I told my research director at Clemson, I said, "Well, I can go to either one of these places, but if I go to Carolina, I can continue to operate this little company I've got going." He said, "Go to Georgia." So, but I went to South Carolina anyway, and I continued to do that, and I did it for the next 35 years. That was my vocation. Well, Kary, when he graduated, he did a few things, and he wound up working at Cetus. He was working. He had gotten into biochemistry by this. He worked with Cetus Corporation. Cetus Corporation was this new outfit that didn't have really any products, but they had a lot of money, spending it on innovative chemists. Kary was one. And he had, nobody ever doubted Kerry's intellect. His motto in the senior annual that we had, "I'll have my fill of knowledge." And he did. He would go after them. Anything he was interested in, he would excel at. And everybody knew how smart he was. Cetus, he was making oligonucleotides. And they were sort of the building blocks you can make, theoretically, you make DNA out of. And there's small pieces. But anyway, when he was driving to his place in Mendocino one, he had this idea. And Kary was never really focused real strongly on one thing, but his focus would travel around. He had a lot of interest, and he absorbed knowledge that people that are really concentrated on a field would not grab. He was driving up to Mendocino, California from Emory, and he was thinking, "Well, we can do it once, we can do it twice." It's a very oversimplification. But he took two concepts that were known, put them together, and invented PCR, polymerase chain reaction, which there were two things that biochemists had a great deal of trouble with: DNA. One was getting the specific thing you wanted without clean up, and getting enough of that to do something. Well, his invention which came about was to do these things, and he said that, "I don't know why it doesn't work." That he couldn't understand why somebody hadn't thought of it. It was so simple, so easy. Why hadn't they? Must be something wrong with it. I don't know what it is. Somebody will tell me, I'm sure. But he came back Cetus Monday, and he kept asking people. They would all come up with some reason why it wouldn't work, but they could never specify why. It took about 6 months, but he finally got an experiment together, got them sort of fun what he was going to do, and he put these things together, and it worked. When it worked, that gave the biochemist specificity and quantity, two things I've never been able to achieve. And it was so simple, it was. DNA is a double helix. And when Watson and Crick determined the structure of it, they noticed that there was a lot of repetition, of sort of duality in there. They thought it would lend itself to some kind of replication. Well, 30 years went by and nobody came up with that solution until Kary. And so for that, he eventually won his award. And he did that in 1983, about in the middle of the 1980s. His invention was shaking up the genetic engineering and biochemistry world. He what did he do? Somebody tell me. he was shaking up the biochemistry. Anyway. There was an article in the paper that was talking about how great this thing was. And I cut it out and I sent it to him and I said, in the margin, I said, save me a ticket for Stockholm. And damn it, about 8 years later, he won the damn Nobel. And I got to go watch him get it. So that was an amazing thing. They have about 10 days worth of ceremonies and stuff. I was there for 7 of them. He was there before I got there, and a couple of days after I left. But it just went on as this fabulous stuff that they put out on that. Got to meet the other people, and it was just wonderful. I gotta go. All right. Anyway, I've got one quote here. People poo-pooed him about that. Said, "Well, anybody could have come up with that. It's nothing big deal what it was." But Arthur Schopenhauer, the philosopher, German Polish philosopher back in the first half of the 19th century, said talent is hitting the target nobody else can hit, but genius hitting the target nobody else. And I've got one other thing here, and I'll be gone. But Tom Brokaw, who had no skin in the game, said, and this to more understand the enormity of what Kary did, Koppel said, take all the MVPs from professional baseball, basketball, and football. Throw in your dozen favorite movie stars and half dozen rock stars for good measure. Add all of the TV anchor people now on the air, and collectively, we have not affected the current good of or the future welfare of mankind as much as Kary Mullis. Thank you on behalf of Kary Mullis. Thank you.
That deserves a standing ovation, if anything.